Well, folks, I asked you to make 10 mana cards that would actually see play. It's a pretty rare thing in Hearthstone these days. And you all made some doozies. We got some crazy cards in this video. Kicking it off here with Archimonde the Defiler from Kogeti. 10 mana, 16-16. Love the big crazy stat line here for Archimonde. And Battle Cry, it's Defile, but on your opponent's deck and also your deck. So deal one damage to all minions in each player's deck. If any die, repeat this effect. So basically, you could wipe out the minions in your opponent's deck. If they had a one health minion and a two health minion and a three health minion, much like a Defile on board, this would progressively damage each of those one by one and eventually kill off that series of minions. Maybe they have a gap. There's no four health minion. Their five health stuff would stay alive. But this is also affecting your deck, and the conditionality is based on both. So you could also run ones, twos, threes, fours, and fives in your deck if you really wanted to ensure that you're able to destroy all these various health totals in your opponent's deck. But then, of course, there's some downside there because you're destroying your own stuff. But theoretically, right, if you ran a deck without many minions or you just wanted to hit key targets, you might be able to like say, okay, this deck has ones and twos and a lot of threes. Maybe I'll run some threes in my deck to get that really high value four health thing. I need to make sure that card dies. So you can kind of build around this and explore some crazy ways to blow up your opponent's stuff. So it's kind of like this, you know, mega ticketist, but I think it's got some cool checks and balances in place to make it feel a little bit more fair. And it requires like, you know, some deck building support and stuff. So I actually don't know if this particular card is crazy OP, right? Because it's not actually affecting the board when you play it. It's this like value thing. It's symmetrical. So there are some real downsides to this one. But I think it's just so cool because Archimonde is called the Defiler. That's like his nickname. And he casts Defile, but in a new and perhaps more interesting way. So I think this is a really, really fun card design here from Kogeti. And in fact, we have his pair also from Kogeti. I wanted to just do both of these. Kill Jaden the Deceiver as well. Another 10 mana 16-16 for Warlock. This one has a battle cry for the rest of the game. Secretly mark half your opponent's cards to discard a card when played. So essentially here, you take all of your opponent's cards in hand and in deck, and half of them are going to have this negative effect applied where anytime they play them, they're going to discard something. So your opponent has this like decision point every time they play a card. It's like, oh God, is this going to discard a card? Do I need to play this other thing first? Oh God, is that going to discard a card? Because they don't know it's secret, which is borrowed from a card, I think Fate Spinner, we saw long, long ago, a keyword or a text that's only been used one time that I can recall. Which was a really cool thing, and I like that this is about deceiving as well. So both of these cards play to the nicknames of the characters as these big giant legendaries, and you create all these problems for your opponent. This could very easily be rewarded to say like your opponent's cards have a 50% chance to discard, and it would basically mean about the same thing. But I like this because it kind of puts the control, at least perception of control, in the opponent's hands, and it's like they control their fate if they're lucky or if they make, you know, good decisions, even though it's totally random. So I like that that creates that kind of despair or like struggle for the opponent to overcome. So I think the word here is actually important from a kind of feel standpoint, even if there might be a more simple way to convey this information. So both of these are just really cool references to very major lore villains for Warcraft, and I think the way they play into their mechanics with their nicknames is just really, really cool. And I don't think these are that powerful. I don't actually know if either of these would see play because they're just so value-focused and late-game-focused, but they're such cool cards. I had to spotlight them anyway. All right, so now let's get one of these just absolutely OP broken cards out of the way. This is definitely one of them, I think. This one is Ikkornen, Eternal Devourer from Andrew Jackson. He's a 10 mana 0/1 dragon, and he is a chunky boy. And his battle cry reads, gain the stats and keywords of all minions you played this game. So that's right, Mr. Smite exists. As a neutral card, you can get charge on this guy, and he's also going to gain a billion stats because presumably you've played a bunch of minions. This could very easily be a 30 plus attack minion when you play it on turn 10 that has charge that just becomes, you know, in many cases, an instant game winner till your opponent plops down that Annoyotron. So very, very scary, but you know, you could also give it lifesteal and taunt and divine shield and every other crazy, thing that would make this either incredibly swingy or I think more likely just a card that hammers face. So could a card like this ever exist? I certainly don't think so. I think it's too good. I think if you made this a 10-10 and it said gain all the keywords, you know, that would be the sort of more balanced version of this so that it could still go face because it'll have lifesteal. Like it could still be really swingy and sticky and stuff, but you know, wouldn't be it necessarily a straight up game ender. Cause I think this is just way too easy to get to so ridiculous attack totals with charge. So, you know, I don't think this card could exist as presented, but it's still got a cool mechanic, right? Gaining all these stats and keywords is fun. So if there was no charge, maybe it would be okay to just plop down a big 30-30 with lifesteal and rush divine shield. It'd still be pretty nuts, but I think with charge existing, this just becomes a little OP. That said, I still really like the idea a lot. It's fun to take a look at these absurdly high powered cards because, you know, 10 mana, you gotta be pretty powerful to get played at 10 mana. This just might be a little too much. Hey, speaking of Annoyotrons, look at this one from the Beholder. This is the Annoyo Giant, a 10 mana 8/8 mech with Divine Shield, Taunt, and Death Rattle. Fill your board with Annoyotrons. Oh my god, I love the idea of this card. It's so defensive, so annoying, so sticky. Imagine this sucker in like a big warrior deck or coming back off a Nazoth, right? It's like, yeah, I dare you to brawl my Nazoth, dude. You're gonna get a board of Annoyotrons. Like, bring it. I just love cards like this, and it really would be the kind of epitome of all the Annoyo style cards. He's just so big and so darn hard to deal with all of these various components. It would probably bring silence back into the meta, but you know, 10 mana is really slow even for a card like this one, so a lot of decks could run this without some kind of big package or ways to cheese it into play sooner. So I don't even think this card would be like crazy overpowered. I think it'd be solid. I think big decks would absolutely adore it, but beyond that, I don't think you want to be spending 10 mana on this all too often. So weirdly, this might be a reasonably powered card despite just how big and crazy it is. Moving on here to Lorthamar Theron from Sunbird 1002. This is a big old 10 mana 8/10 for Hunter, and it reads, Battlecry casts 5 random Hunter secrets. So you get some immediate tempo out of this guy on top of his body, some disruption on board. Basically, that's like 10 mana worth of secrets right there. And, you know, because they're random, your opponents are going to have a really hard time diffusing all of those in a successful way. And on top of that, this card has a very cool bonus. This game, your triggered secrets remain in play until the turn ends. So, for instance, you play this, you get 5 secrets, right? And you get, like, let's just say Freezing Trap for the sake of making it easier. Your opponent has 5 minions on board. Normally, they'd attack, they'd proc the Freezing Trap, and then the other 4 would be free to attack. But in this case, the Freezing Trap would remain in play. So if they attacked with all 5 minions, they would all get Freezing Trapped. Now, they wouldn't do that, of course. They just leave them sitting there on board. But basically, a single Freezing Trap denies your opponent from dealing any minion damage on board. They just can't attack with stuff. So this would actually be a fairly safe card to plop down, because like explosive traps might go off 3 or 4 times. It could just deal like a ton of damage. Misdirections could go off multiple times and cause absolute chaos and havoc. You know, snipes could go off every time your opponent plays a minion and he just wouldn't be able to do anything. So it's actually pretty crazy swingy, and I think very strong, like very, very powerful, because like your opponent may just not be able to get through these secrets. Now, they would go away at the end of the turn. It's not like they'd never be able to play minions again, right? It's just each one would have this kind of one turn punish. They'd want to trigger them all and then just kind of have a dead turn, because they wouldn't probably be able to do much depending on the secret package. And then beyond that, if you're running secrets in your deck on top of that, it's a this game effect. So the next time you play a Freezing Trap, you're again just going to completely lock down your opponent's board. Really, really cool effect here. I don't know if Lorthamar is like the best character to capture this. Doesn't exactly feel like Lorthamar to me, but You know, regardless, I think it's a really neat way to have this like super end game secret package, which again, for a 10 mana card, it has to be nuts. This is nuts. Is it too good? You guys tell me. Moving on here to King Magni from Minavat. Big old 10 mana 10/10 for warrior. He's got taunt, which is nice, and battle cry, double your armor. Now, we've seen this style of effect mentioned in quite a few custom cards in the past. And this is really a win more card in many ways, right? Because if you get to turn 10 and you have a significant enough amount of armor that this card feels compelling to play, you're probably winning the game anyway. So, you know, going from 20 armor to 40 or whatever, how often does that really change the outcome of a game? There are some specific instances, I think, where it's like you're playing a combo deck, you know, that has a limited amount of burst damage. Think about, you know, like Rogue until it's about to be nerfed. Might have some very significant breakpoints where if you get past that, they can't kill you. Usually that's happening before turn 10, but you know, you can imagine scenarios where decks like that exist. The other side of this is like, maybe you need to stack up enough armor to get something like a Silas OTK down. So I don't think this is strictly a win more card. I think there are some ways to convert this armor into meaningfully being decisive about winning a game or not. So I would love a card like this. Love the character, love big defensive cards. This is just like very iconic looking for a Hearthstone card. So I would be all over this one. Sign me up. All right, moving on here to Algalon the Observer from Daniel Baklava. This is a 10 mana 10/10 yet again, and it has a start of game effect. Choose a future timeline. And this is really cool, referencing these kind of like different things that could happen in Azeroth, the world being at war, the fell energies and demons destroying things, the wilderness taking over with ceaseless wilderness, or an invasion of void consuming the planet as well. Like, very cool thematic home run here, as far as I'm concerned, for both Algalon and all of these outcomes that might exist. Now, from a power level standpoint, I actually think this card can be ratcheted up a little bit. It is a free start of game effect, so I think Daniel here was very cognizant of that fact and was like trying to make sure it didn't feel too good for something that's sort of free. But I maintain it's not actually that free. You do have to run a dead card in your deck. You know, Algalon's going to chill in your mulligan sometime and disrupt things, and he's going to hurt your win rate on occasion. So I think it's okay for the rewards to be good, particularly because they come so late in a game, right? They're all happening at turn 10, as you can see when you read these. So, you know, it's a mix of stuff. Each player is get a 3-2 weapon and draw two cards. When you reach 10 mana, deal 5 damage to both heroes. That one in particular just doesn't seem like that's going to make a big impact. You can destroy all minions when you get to 10 mana, or restore 10 health to each hero when you get to 10 mana. So, you know, like the Ceaseless Wilderness, for instance, when you reach 10 mana, restore 10 health to each hero. That's kind of like a Dungar effect, right? And it takes longer. Like, yes, again, it's start a game, it's free, so I get that. But I think you could push these a little bit further and it would still feel reasonable enough, and not every deck would feel compelled to run this, because some aggro decks would be like, yeah, sure, it'd be great to have 5 damage when I get to turn 10, but can I really afford the 10 drop? You know, it's going to be a dead card so often. So there are still downsides to running Algalon. So, you know, if it said deal 8 damage to both heroes, might be okay, right? These are also symmetrical effects, so that's another way to balance these. So all in all, love the execution of this card in so many ways. I just might tweak the numbers, but I'm curious to hear what you all think. All right, moving on here to Adal from Drunk Dwarf. Big old 10 mana 4/10 for Priest and Paladin dual class. Battlecry, add a copy of each holy spell you cast this game to your hand, and then gain life equal to your hand size. Gain life is not a phrase I guess we use in Hearthstone much, but I'm assuming that means gain health. Maybe you can go above 30. So, you know, maybe in a pinch heal to give you some breathing room to play a doll, or maybe just a way to get some bonus health if you're at 30 and it works that way. On top of that, just a lot of value generation here, filling your hand basically with holy spells. On average, you assume you've played enough to make this worth it, or you're building your deck in a way to do that. So in a way, you know, it could be like a Lady Liadrin number 2 for a Librum Paladin. I don't know if they need that. This feels a little slower, or a way to get a ton of healing and value in Priest. Now, I think this is the kind of card that wouldn't ever really get played in Hearthstone as we see it today. It's just too value-oriented. I don't think the life gains offering enough survivability or enough breathing room to play this sort of card. I'm glad that's there. That helps. But I think it might need more to really make it worth it. You know, this could even maybe say, like, make the holy spells cost 0. That would be like a Yashiraj or Yogg-Saron style effect, right? And I don't even know if that'd be totally out of whack. Maybe it could be a limited number so it doesn't, you know, go crazy. Maybe it's like add 5 holy spells to your hand, they cost 0, or they cost 3 less or something, you know, put some caps on it. But there could be some sort of tempo modifier here to make many of the holy spells immediately playable to speed this card up. So great effect, really cool character that I'd like to see in Hearthstone at some point. And, you know, very fitting holy spell, light stuff, all tying together here nicely. But I might push this one just a little bit harder again. All right, so this one does not need pushed. I think this is like one of the most broken cards I've ever seen in a custom card video. It's really strong. It comes from Sadathar, 10 mana, 7/7 demon, soulmonger. Keep in mind, this is not a legendary. This is an epic. So you can have 2 of these in your deck. Battlecry, destroy your hand and deal damage equal to the total cost randomly split among all enemies. So basically here, if you had a hand that was magically, you know, 10 cards, or I guess it'd be 9 cards after you play this, that was all 10 mana, you'd be able to deal 90 damage to your opponent's stuff. So remember, a completed C'Thun does 30 damage. Now, C'Thun's not a great card. C'Thun does not see play in real decks in Hearthstone right now. But you'd be pretty happy to have a non-conditional C'Thun chilling in your hand and have 2 of them, so you're pretty likely to draw it, and being able to play a C'Thun just whenever you want on turn 10. Because it's not hard to get to 30 damage, for instance, off of mana cost. If you have 9 cards in hand, to get to 30 damage, you really only need like a little over 3 mana average per card to get to 30. And I would say if you're playing a deck like this, you've probably got a lot of cards in the 4 to 5 to 6 mana range, right? So you're probably looking at 40 damage very often when you play Soulmonger. So he's just a C'Thun that's ready to go for 10 mana. And that's either going to just totally wipe your opponent's board or very, very often just completely kill them. Now, if it weren't lethal, like, yes, of course, like, you've discarded your hand, it's going to be hard to catch up, maybe. But I think very often it would be enough to secure lethal, particularly if you built your deck around this, you know? Just keep some high-cost stuff in there, get a few 8 drops in there, and suddenly this is, like, going to deal 40, 50, 60 damage without too much trouble. So, I don't know. This card's really scary to me. Maybe it's not the most broken ever, because, you know, if your opponent has a board, they're still going to be able to do stuff. But it's just the consistency, the reliability, right? It's just an on-demand C'Thun with no downside. There's 2. Well, there's downside, but, you know, if it wins the game, there's no downside. There's 2 of them in your deck. It's just, like, completely crazy to me. So I don't think a card like this could exist. You know, if it said, like, destroy 5 cards in hand, you know, I think maybe it would be okay. You'd have to, like, high roll it. It wouldn't have quite as much consistency. Like, that might be okay. If it's a legendary, I'd feel better about it. So at least, you know, it was maybe harder to draw. You didn't always hit it very reliably. There's a few things that could perhaps keep Soulmonger in a little bit healthier spot. But as it stands, I think it's just way too strong. So that wraps it up for this custom card video. And next time around, I want you to submit some more custom cards, and I want you to base them off of artwork from the Mercenaries game mode. We got all these cool, like, alternate versions of characters we know and love. Some of them look like super sick, powered up. You know, like King Crush is on fire. What would a fiery King Crush look like? What does this Millhouse green orb thing look like in a Hearthstone card? What is this Mookla? Maybe he, like, casts a banana on himself for every card in your opponent's hand, right? That's a cool Mookla design because he's got all these bananas. So I've dropped a link in the description, as always, to the form to submit your next custom card. I'll also include a link to the gallery for all of these mercenary artworks. I want you to pick one, take an idea that's inspired from the artwork or just the character, use the art in a cool way, because I'm not playing mercenaries, but I love all this awesome art. I'd love to see it and get to enjoy it. So take some artwork, make a cool custom card based on that that tells a story or utilizes art in some neat way, and submit that, and we'll do it for next time around. So that said, share your thoughts on all these cards in the comments below. Thanks much, as always, for watching, and until next time, game on.